So like as we discussed so far about the cursor, like we have two types of cursors, right? Implicit cursor and explicit cursor. So implicit cursor by default, you know, like the opening operation, fetching operation, closing of the cursor will be taken care by the Oracle seeded PL SQL engine. But coming to the explicit cursor, as a developer, we have to write an explicit code for the purpose of opening, closing, as well as fetching. So we have set of attributes which using which we can control the iteration or control the behavior of the cursor. I mean, this is like when you are using a cursor with a loop, until unless you have a cursor attribute, you cannot control that. So the, in that scenario, you require this. And here these cursor attributes not only works with just a cursor, but there is one kind of cursor, like cursor attribute called rowCon, which works with the DML operation also. Okay. So like last time when we have used a cursor with a not found kind of stuff, right? So where we used it, like whenever the fetch operation fails, you want to come out of the loop, that is where, you know, we have used the not found operation. So these ease open stuff, you know, let us say if you want to validate, like until generally like a fetch operation works only when the cursor is open. So for every, like whenever you perform a fetch operation, make sure that you have an open of that cursor. Using that, you can control whether you're using that, you can find out whether the cursor is open or not. If it is open, then only you can perform a fetch operation. So let us see the functionality of a row count. Okay. So like in this is row count is very different kind of concept. I mean to say like this row count attribute works with the DML operation also. Okay. Let us see how this works. So what we can do is I'll just take one, you know, like some custom table. Okay. Maybe I'll just insert some pivot data and I want to perform some update on that. And so I want to validate whether my update is successful or not. So this is kind of, you know, like a very different logic. In this kind of logic is generally used, you know, like when you want to perform the updation and you want to validate whether data got updated or not. Based on that, you want to send the response code to the calling system. Okay. So what I'll do is I'll just copy some data from the pivot table to my custom table. Okay, I don't want to perform on the seeded table update. So that's why. So I'll just take some dummy data. Pivot header ID. Or let us take something like a GL ledgers, right? This should be fine too. So I'll just say, okay, create table xx gl underscore ledgers as, will this work? This table is not existing as of now. Xx gl underscore ledger is not available as of now, but if I perform this operation, will this work?
It should work, Shilo.
Okay. So what it will do, like what operations it will perform?
It will create a table as GL underscore ledgers. Okay. Same structure.
Mm-hmm. Same structure. And will it copy data also?
Yes.
It will copy data also.
Yeah, okay. So now this is having... So generally, like whenever you want to perform some kind of updation or you want to validate your logic better, this is the best way to do it on the theory table. Like I just copy, just duplicate like this. Okay. Now we'll have all the data in this table and then we can perform whatever the way, whatever the things which we want. Okay. Now what I want to do is let us say, so I just want to validate the functionality of row count. Okay. So like wherever the value is vision in the short name, I want to replace with the XX vision. Okay. So for that, I just want to use a row count attribute. So declare, begin, end. So now cursor C underscore GL ledger is equal to select star from XXGL underscore ledgers, right? Now for Rick in the underscore, okay, loop and loop. Okay, so now, so here. Here itself, we can, you know, there are many ways of doing it, right? So let us say the short name is if where short name, like, so better just get the data where the short name itself, like that, right? So then wherever you have that kind of stuff, so here what I'll do is update xx your ledger where ledger id is equal to big dot ledger id and short name is equal to, okay, big dot short name. Okay, now then what I'll do is, if here just simply your line dot SQL percentile row count. Fine. Yeah. So let's try. Okay. Right, so here it is telling, right, like a number of rows updated, but see what is the error, other error, it could be some other error. Okay, it's because of length, value is too large, something like that. That's a different story, but here if you observe, it is clearly telling number of rows updated one for this ledger 478 480 501. For other it gave an error, but what I can do is, are you getting what I'm trying to tell you? Or maybe we can try on the other attribute, like let us try on the description, because as the size is becoming too heavy for that, so I'm just trying to change the description of this one, this existing description with the prefix by xx. So, but how do I know whether the updation is successful or not? How do we know update statement is successful or not? So successful doesn't mean that it is really updating it, right? So how, you want to know how many records it updated also. You want to know how many records it updated. So now here, if I execute, let's see, can you see everywhere it says the road, like a number of records updated one. Here, what I'll do is I'll just do one change here. Let us say if I remove the where class, what is the expectation here? This update statement will update how many records? It will update all the records with the, which are there in the GL table. So here, if you observe, there are 204 records in this one. If you try to execute this particular program, it will update the 204 records. Right? Can you see? For every loop, for every iteration, it is updating 204 records. Right? So using this particular SQL percentile row count attribute, you can find out how many records you are getting updated. Okay, that is the functionality of this particular attribute. Here. So this is very much useful when you want to like send the response to the calling system saying that whether your update is successful or not. If it is successful, how many records it updated? So using this, you can validate. So that's the functionality of this particular row count attribute. And here, if you observe, what kind of cursor it is? It is an implicit cursor. Like I'm just talking about this one, SQL percentile row count. This functionality is an implicit cursor or a explicit cursor?
Explicit cursor.
The SQL row SQL percentile row count functionality is an implicit cursor functionality. The reason is very simple.
Yeah.
So when you are performing an update, the execution of the statement, whatever the internal operation, it is getting taken care internally. So as a developer, we are not aware what is happening in the background. Okay. So clear?
So will it display for each record or for overall it will display how it is?
For every update operation, for every update operation, you'll have a different row count. I mean to say, like whenever you perform any DML operation, a cursor will be executed in the background for every DML operation. Insert, update, delete also. Now let us say you can try in the similar way. You can try deletion also. Now what I can do is, I'll say just delete from this one. That's it. So I'm just commenting this existing update statement for understanding purpose. I just mentioned delete star from the ledger. And if you just see the row count, okay, what it is telling? Why? Okay, not required star, right? Can you see? So it just deleted 204, and the next iteration, you know, like as there was no data, it just simply saying zero. Of course, it is not committed, but okay. And in similarly, if you just see the insertion also, you'll have the same functionality. Not only deletion, we have seen for update, we have seen for delete, and you can just see for the insertion also. Let's say insert into ledger ID. Values. I'll just say minus one. Let's see. Why nothing printed? Okay, let me roll back. Okay. No, data is there, right? Data should be there in this. Yeah, it is there. Because I have not mentioned anywhere commit, so obviously data will be there. Okay, it's because of some other constraints, fine. Okay, short name is also mandatory. I think all are mandatory, I guess. Similarly, you can try for description. Okay. Okay, man, let me remove this constraints on this, okay? I don't want any constraints on this. Okay. Let's try. Fine. So here if you observe, now even like for every insertion also, it is just performing, you know, like the SQL percent of row count is getting updated for that. Fine. So this one is very, very much important concept. And that is especially for the DML operations. Okay. Yeah, so we'll see some other functionality now. this we have seen. So we have seen a for loop with the cursor, right? Like even the current example also is based on a for loop with a cursor. So using for loop, you can mention the cursor name, the explicit cursor name, or you can mention the query directly. So, but it is advisable to mention the cursor directly rather than mentioning the query. But generally, both goes well in any in the real-time applications also. So here, okay. So this is for loop using a subquery.
So we were deleting the records, right? For the first time, it is deleted all the 204 records.
Yeah.
And it was keep iterating, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we can stop that, right? So you should. So after the once it is deleting the 204 records, you should not iterate again. So how can we do that in that?
Yeah, you can mention a percentile row count there itself. If a percentile row count is equal to zero, then you can stop there. You can mention that. See, in this case, see, generally when you're deleting the data, you will not do a blank delete, right? You'll not do a blank delete. So you will be mentioning some condition. In our case, we are reading from the same query and we're deleting from the same table, right? We are reading from the same table as well as deleting from the same table. Generally, you may have some condition, right? And also we have not mentioned any commit. So
yeah.
So those are all things to be considered while performing these kind of operations. So for loop with a SQL query, it is just similar to what you use a for loop with a cursor. Okay. So this we have seen.
And this SQL is prefixed for all the cursor variables.
Can you repeat SQL?
SQL percentile we have given a for loop count right now. So similarly, that SQL percentile is the prefix is common for all the cursor variables.
No, for other cursor variables, like you just mentioned cursor name followed by percentile, right? Like maybe if you see, okay, let us see.
Only for a row count, we'll use the SQL percentile.
Yeah. Let us say. Okay. Let's say I'll just comment this one also for now. So I just have this if condition. So inside it is cursor is open, right? Outside before for loop, the cursor was never open. So it has to display not open stuff. So, okay. Okay, so here if you observe, right? So before for loop, what it is telling? The cursor is not open. But inside for loop, it is saying cursor is open. Maybe you can also write similar statement after for loop. You should say the cursor is closed. I mean, similarly, like cursor is not open kind of thing. Got it? So here is, if you see, right? Can you see the last statement is not open? After for loop is done, so if you remember, whenever you're using a for loop with a cursor, the open operation, the fetch operation, closing operation is done automatically. Okay, so the closing is done automatically by the for loop. Clear? Yeah, so. Yeah, so this one, like other thing what we want to discuss with the cursor is, like so far, maybe I'm just repeating again. Implicit cursor, select with into clause. Explicit cursor, like explicit cursor, you can just declare explicitly by using a cursor keyword, or you can use a for loop with a query. Now, the other functionality, what we are trying to do now is cursor with a parameter. generally we call it as parameterized cursors, or you can call it as a cursor with a parameter. So what is the difference here is, like, so far what are the queries which we have designed, we have hard coded the conditional variables. I meant to say, let us say generally, like, in a big application system, you will not fetch the data, like, you will not fetch all the records at a time, right? So you may require some parameters to be passed so that you'll get only the required data. So in those kind of scenarios, what you have to do is you have to pass the parameter to the cursor. That is what we call it as parameterized cursor. So let us see how we can pass a parameter to the cursor. Okay. So the remaining functionality is as it is. The remaining functionality, the open, fetch, close, the for loop, everything is same. The only thing is we are just passing the parameter. So how do we pass is a difference. Okay. Parameterized cursor.sql. So let us write a query to fetch the 100 items from a specific inventory org. Okay, to fetch the first 100 items from an inventory org. 100 items from an inventory org. So to do this, what we have to do? We just need to join with both tables, right? MTL system item, B, MSIB. Similarly, INV, our parameters, IOP, where one is equal to one, is equal to IOP dot organization ID. Maybe just get only limited set of parameters now. Segment one. Organization code, right? Something wrong. Line number 11. MTL system items, BMSIB. What is wrong then? Oh, it is MTL parameters, right? Okay, not IOP. Fine. So in Fusion, it was IOP, so. Parameters MSIB organization, yeah, expected. This is always a mistake for me. Fine. So now, like, we are getting all the data, right? Let us assume that we want to pass the organization code as an input to this cursor. Okay. Now I'll just say organization code is equal to this one. Now we are getting this data, and also let us add few more parameters, maybe inventory flag or item lookup code or something, right? It's not coming. Let's write this one. So let's start from till system item B. Enable flag description. Let us add enable the flag and description. Okay. So far this is fine for us. Okay. Now instead of hard coding now, right? So what I'll do is, instead of hard coding like this, I will pass the organization code at runtime. So as of now I'll just copy this. So just do the declare begin and now here. I'll just say L underscore V underscore R underscore code where care 100 is equal to V1. Now I'll just say cursor C item data is mentioned in cursor name. Okay. Now let us see if you hard code, this is how you pass it, right? If you are doing the earlier kind of way, you'll just hard code the data, but we don't want to hard code it. So what you do is, so similar declaration, no change. Only thing is in the cursor name, just declare your variables. Generally, like a cursor name, we always use C underscore. Similarly, cursor variables also will always use a C underscore. So I'll just say CR underscore code and mention the data type. CR code, mention the data type. Now mention this variable, that's it. Mention the cursor variable. Okay. Now to just validate whether the syntax so far what we have done is correct or not, just try to compile it. So if it doesn't give any error, it means the code is correct. So now what you can do, fetch the data, c underscore, get data, loop, end loop. But we have to pass the cursor variable, right? We have to pass the value. So while performing the open operation, so while mention the cursor name, mention the cursor variable value also. Mention the value which you want to pass to that particular cursor parameter. So that's the only difference. Now we can just print it, output dot put underscore line, reg dot segment one, reg dot description, reg dot enable client. Okay, maybe you can just have description like this, number of ways of doing it, but item number comma description, if at all if you want to generate a CSV file, this is how we can do it generally. What we'll do is we'll write this information before for loop so that your header information is not repeated for each iteration, only the content will be repeated. Okay, now just execute. Okay, now we got some error. Okay, so what is telling c underscore get data? Okay, the cursor name is wrong, right? C item data it should be. And we got some other error, dbms underscore output dot put underscore line. Okay, so the error is this one, right? Concatenation. Okay, the data should be concatenated. Now try again. Okay, still we got some error. So it could be overflow. Can you see? Because of the data overflow. Because of data overflow, you got this issue. Maybe let us say, if you increase this data, right? If you increase this particular size, then you should not face any issue. But that is not a good practice. Okay, that's not a good practice. Let us say, I just increase the buffer size. You may not get that issue. Can you see? Now we are not getting any issue at all. You're not getting an issue. It iterated. It retrieved all the data which is matching with that particular criteria. Okay, clear. So far, clear or any doubt?
Can you just repeat, Sriram, this parameter?
Yeah. Okay. See now here, if you observe, right? So in this particular one, what is the extra thing you are seeing here is like some other variable. Okay. So we are just seeing a variable called cursor variable. And what is this cursor variable means? Like whatever the cursor which is declared inside the cursor, for that you want to pass some dynamic parameter at runtime. Okay, while declaring the cursor itself, we are telling what parameters it is expecting. It should expect. So CR code is something the value.
Can you scroll up?
Yeah.
Declare.
Yeah, declare, and this cursor variable.
So and we have to declare this cursor variable inside the cursor, right?
Cursor, which one?
We are not declaring in the declare section.
Cursor
C underscore R code.
Yeah, yeah, it is not, no, yeah. We should not declare anything. The cursor variables, they are specific to cursor only.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is how we'll write as a parameter.
Yeah, correct.
So R code value it will take from the cursor query.
No. Here if you observe, right, just see the line number 2, what we have done, we just declared a temporary variable. And here if you observe, like just consider only this particular cursor query. Now what is happening? We have defined a cursor, and this is a total cursor query, and we have some variable. So here it will not give an error. Let us say if you just try to compile only this part, it will surely give an error, because C underscore R is never a column of any other table which we mentioned. So now that is the reason what we mentioned is, we explicitly mentioned, boss, this is not your table column. This is a parameter which you will which you will get passed at runtime. So that is why you have to declare here. Okay.
What is the use of this?
No, in the real time, you will never execute any query without any parameter. That is not at all a good practice at all. Impossible. Because you will have a very huge set of data, right? Now let us say, I'll tell you, like maybe, so generally like in the B2B integration, right? Assume that you are using Oracle EBS. I have a third party system which manufactures items. So what I want to do is I'll just pass inventory org data and inventory org details, and you just send me the latest item numbers every day. So in those scenarios, what you do, you'll not fetch me all the data, right? You'll fetch me the data for a given item number and some other criteria. So basic thing is, any query whichever you execute, you always have a parameter. If you observe your code also, any query whichever query you consider, you'll always have a parameter. I mean to say some criteria. You'll have some criteria, right? Without that, it is very difficult. Of course, in some scenarios, you may get the total bulk data, but generally, if at all, if you require to fetch the data based on some criteria.
You mentioned the R code, C underscore R code, right?
Yeah.
C underscore R code, where care to, that is the cursor parameter. For that parameter, value from which table it will take?
Okay, see, first, this is a declaration part, right? Whatever we are seeing now, this is a declaration part. Now, you have to pass the value to that variable while executing the cursor. So here, if you observe, what I'm doing, line number 15, I open the cursor, nothing but I'm just calling the cursor inside the using a for loop concept, right? So here I just pass the value L underscore V underscore R code. So what will happen is, this LVR code will get replaced with the CR code. Nothing but this value will be passed to CR code at runtime. At runtime, what will happen is C underscore R underscore code becomes LV underscore R code. This is what it happens. Okay, that's how it will work. Okay, if at all if you have multiple parameters, they same fashion. If at all if you have multiple parameters, what you can do, it'll just mention the comma separated data. Nothing but here also you'll declare the comma separated list of values. And here also while passing it, you'll pass that comma separated list of values.
Okay.
Let us just do the one more simple example.
Logic, how it will replace.
Which one? No, here you can see, this is a cursor name, right? This is your cursor name. And you're passing some variable. So what will happen? So as per your cursor definition, you're passing some value to this variable. So CR code will have the value of LVR code. Because while you're calling, you're invoking a cursor by passing a value, right?
Yeah.
So that's how it happens. So you're invoking a function, you are passing some value, parameter value, right? Okay. So let us see one more sample. In this case, we'll just take one more extra parameter. I'll just say item number also as an input. Similar sample, but just multiple parameters, okay? Now what we'll do, we'll just take one item number, F5000 or something. So this is my item number. Now what I want to, I just want to consider this one. And MSIB item number is equal to, just see here, just validate whether this works or not. So what I have done here, I have not declared any cursor parameter. I have not declared any cursor parameter, but I just assign the temporary variable which I have defined in my declared section, which I have declared in the declared section. Just observe whether this works or not. So what it is telling?
Validate.
No, this is segment one, right? Not item number, correct?
Yes.
Can you see? It got worked?
Yeah.
Clear? Either you can pass the parameter using a cursor parameter logic, or whatever the column which is available in your declared section, that also will work. Okay. But cursor parameter is advisable because, why it is advisable? Because maybe what will happen is whatever the variable which is hard coded in the cursor, only using that variable you can pass the value, isn't it? Are you getting? What I mean to say is, now let us say if you want to pass another item number, you can't just mention here. You can't mention here. You have to change the item number in the variable. Then only you can get a different data. Now, I'll show you right away. Now let us say. Now this was like the above for loop was getting only one record, right? F50,000. Okay. Now what I'll do is, let us say I'll get other one. 86831. So here. Now, if at all, if I want to fetch the data of this particular item number, what I have to do? You just change the value. You change the value of this item number now, and you should get the data from this particular item number of this item number. Now, just re-execute. Can you see? Got it? After changing the value of this item number, I'm able to fetch this data. And earlier I was getting this data. Clear?
Yeah.
Okay. So cursor, you can use a cursor variables. That is one way. Or you can use the normal declare, whatever the variable which you mentioned in the declared section. That is all. That also will work with the cursor. Fine. Now, so like a one other part of the cursor is like a dynamic concept. Like there are two things in the dynamic cursor. I mean to say, like so far we have seen implicit, explicit, okay, and other thing is called ref cursor, and there is some other concept called dynamic SQL. Okay, so we'll cover up both parts in the next session. So what I'll do is maybe we'll take separate session for that, now to include with this one. Now shall I cover exception or shall I wind up? Exception, shall we cover up or no?
We see like 2-3 more examples of this.
You want more samples of cursor, you're saying? Or?
Yeah.
Okay. See. What we can do is, let us take a few other queries now. Just close this. Let's say. Let us take the HZ parties one, okay? HZ parties with the customer data, invoices. These are party data, right? And are a customer transaction all. This is a customer invoice. AR invoice, I mean to say. Transaction dot customer transaction ID. TRX number is it? Yeah, okay. And what is the party ID name? Is it sold to or something? No, not sold to. Not sold. Party ID will have it, right? Sold to customer ID. Yeah?
Sold to customer ID.
Yeah, okay. Sold to customer ID. Okay. Now, what I want to do is I just want to join with the headset, this one. HZ party table. So we have to join with HZ cust accounts, right? Let's see. A party HP where 1 = 1 and HP dot party. Take one transaction number for now, or else customer transaction ID. Okay. So far, okay. Okay, I think we are missing some join, right? Okay. So we have to join. Yeah. Sold to party ID, right? Sold to customer ID. SJ dot cust account ID. Okay.
Party ID.
Come again. party name, nothing but customer name, right? Account name. Correct? Or any mistake? Okay. Now what I want to do is, let us say my requirement is, I just want to get all the invoices based on a customer name. Requirement is to get the list of invoices from a specific customer, as well as with a specific transaction number. So maybe what we can do is just see this example. Now this is our query, right? Let us consider this query. And first, as of now, initially we'll just consider this particular parameter. Okay. So I'll just copy this query now. See, as of now, you know, like we have not discussed about the logic of procedure and a function. We have been dealing with only the anonymous block, right? So we may not totally visualize the overall picture where exactly it is used. So as of now, we are not looking about where it is used. We are just looking about the functionality of how it works. So once we have a clarity on the procedure or function, then we'll get a clarity where exactly it is used, why it is used, and all those things. So let's see. Parameterized cursor. Declare begin end. Okay. Now cursor C underscore get invoices is fine. Now, so we know that there are two ways of declaring cursor variable, either using a cursor parameter or you can just declare within the declare section. But I always advise to go with this way. But if it is an existing code, just do whatever you want. So party name varchar2. See, now what I'm doing? So I'm declaring a cursor variable with a party name here, nothing but a customer name.
Yeah.
So I'll pass here as HP dot party name is equal to C party name. So far clear?
Yeah.
Now what you do is, like, when you're writing your program initially, like maybe if you are not familiarized with the kind of syntax and all those things, right? Always do a small set of coding. Don't write a big programs initially. Obviously, you'll get stuck. And also, whatever the SQL part which you write inside a PL/SQL, first of all, design your SQL query separately and make sure that if it is syntactically free and if it is working fine, then copy paste the same thing here. Now just execute this here. It should not give an error. Now means, like, so far it is good. Yeah. Now I'll remove the null part. Okay. Now the next thing what we can do is, like, you can just make use of our for loop concept. For RET in C get invoice. And now whenever you have a cursor with a parameter, you need to pass it. Let us say now this time what I'll do is, let us say I'll not pass the value. See what will happen, what error it gives. Just see what error it gives. Can you see? Compilation error it is giving. Yeah, somewhere it is clearly telling, right, the number of arguments, wrong number or argument types of arguments in a call to see get invoice, right? Now let us say if I pass null, will it work? Do you get an error or not? That is my question. Will you get an error or not?
Scroll down.
Yeah.
We will not get it.
We are passing, so, like, initially when we are not passing any value, it gave that you are missing some argument. Now I'm passing a null value for the argument. For the party name, I'm just passing the value as null. What will happen now? Do we get any records or will it give any syntactic?
We will not get it. Yeah, party name, if we have any null values, that will retrieve.
The party name cannot be null, right? Obviously.
So it will not, this will get executed.
So you mean to say you will not get any compilation issue, correct?
Yes.
Okay. See now, right? No compilation issue because we are passing a null value for the party name. So obviously it is a correct one. But can you just tell me, like, was the code entered into the loop or not? Was the code entered inside the loop or not?
Means.
I mean to so say,
it has not entered into the loop.
inside the loop. I mean to say whether we have passed the null value. So now C underscore get invoice will not get any data, and you're performing iteration using a record variable. So when the C get invoice is not having any data, will it enter the loop or not? It will not enter, right? Because it is not having any data at all. So obviously it will not enter. Okay, that is what I just was asking. Right. So nothing is like, I mean, we have not seen any log. So obviously it means that it did not enter. We can try revalidate again. What I can do is, let us say I'll just pass this one, world of business, as my input. So here I'm directly hard coding, instead of, you know, like using a temporary variable, I'm just hard coding the value to, like, I'm just passing the direct value rather than using a variables. Okay, we can pass this way also, right? Okay.
Yeah.
Just see. Can you see? It's just say printing inside the loop. So nothing but that. We are getting good amount of records now, right? We can just print invoice number. So that transaction underscore number. Yeah. Now we'll retry again. Can you see now? You're getting a different invoice data. Okay. Now let us say. So far what it is doing, it is just providing all the invoice data based on the party name. Okay. Now what I want to do is I just want to consider one more parameter. I just want to consider one more parameter. So what are the changes I have to do? I want to consider transaction number as an input. What are the changes I have to do? So now here, if you observe, I want to consider one more parameter called transaction number. So what I'll do is, like, I just want to pass it via cursor parameter. So I'll just declare transaction number like this, varchar2. Okay. Now, and similarly, transaction dot transaction number is equal to C underscore transaction number. Okay. And now what we can do, just pass some transaction number. Pass a transaction number. As of now, I'm passing a valid transaction number. So we are expecting data now. Okay. So we should get only one record now. So what is the change I have done? I just added one more, like, a line, like this condition I have added, and I added this particular extra parameter in the cursor variable. And now while passing also, you have to pass the value. Okay. Else it does not understand whether it will not understand the second parameter. Okay. Now can you see? We just got only.
But values it will take respectively for the parameter, cursor parameter.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay. So this how we can just pass, you know, like multiple parameters to the cursor. So the similar manner, let us say if you want to pass any number of variables, this is how we can deal it. Okay. And let us say if I pass null, what will happen? If I pass null, what will happen? Will we get any data now?
No.
We'll not get any data, right?
Yes.
Okay, let us execute. Right, so we are not getting any data. Let us assume that what I want to do is, so as of now we are having two parameters, but the requirement is, let us say the second parameter is not mandatory. So as per the requirement, second parameter is not mandatory. So how do we solve this particular issue? So let us see, if I don't pass the value for this particular second parameter, still I have to get the data. So what is the thing I have to change in the query? What logic I have to apply here? So using what logic we should apply so that we can get the solution?
No, ask me your question again, Sila.
What I want to do is, see, now I have two parameters. Okay. So until unless I pass the correct data, I will not get the data. So my requirement is, Only the first parameter is mandatory. Second parameter is not mandatory. Either I can pass the null or I can pass the exact transaction number. So if I pass null, I have to still have to get all the data with respect to that particular party name.
Cursor percentile column type.
Okay.
Rotor NVL.
Nothing like that.
NVL.
NVL, right? Mm-hmm. Whenever you have deal with NVL, nulls, that's it. NVL is the only solution. So now, what this will do? If at all, if you pass the null, if at all, if the value is null, it will just compare transaction number with transaction number. That's it. Okay. Clear?
Before we given only CTRX number.
Yeah. Now here, if you observe, I'll tell you. Now let us say if I pass the transaction number. Can you tell me how many records you'll get it? Now I change the query. I have changed the query now. Okay, let me check whether it's correct or not. Yeah, let me pass the correct transaction number. Okay. Now I'm passing the correct transaction number and the correct party name. And as per my database, I have one record. So now as per our query, will we get that single record or not? Or do we get multiple records or zero records?
Single record.
We'll get one single record, right?
Yeah.
Clear? Now, let us say if I remove this, if I pass null, what will happen?
It will show all the transactions for the world of business.
Yes, it will execute the data, which is passing only this one. And wherever you have a transaction number, wherever you're passing the value as null, it'll just simply replace at runtime, right? Okay, got it? So this is where you can use the null concept also. Fine. Any questions?
Yeah.
Fine. Okay. Yeah. So anything you want to consider in the cursor?
So what is the cursor? Just can you give me an overview?
No, we'll discuss that in a separate session. We'll have a dynamic concept and this ref cursor, right? But for your understanding purpose, I can tell you, see, the basic purpose of ref cursor is, see, now what we have done, like for in our example,
what is the name?
Which cursor?
Ref cursor.
Okay.
See.
Any full form there or
not really. Reference cursor, or I'm not sure, but. So like when you're declaring a cursor, explicitly what you're doing, we just mentioned some query name like this, right? A query like this, but now using a ref cursor, what you'll do is the cursor variable can hold the result of any query. I mean to say, now in this scenario, let us say in this one, what we'll do, like in the first scenario, let us say if you see cpivot data, so this cpivot data will always bind it to this particular query, nothing but the cpivot data cursor will hold only this particular data. But now when I use a ref cursor, let us say if I use a ref cursor concept with some different syntax, I'll just say ref c data. So now this ref c data is another cursor which can hold the result of any SQL query. The SQL query is not constant, the SQL query is dynamic in this scenario. So in the explicit cursor scenario, what was happening is, come again.
In this cursor, we are using the cursor inside one cursor.
Not really. What I mean to say is, now here, you have this cursor variable. So the query is static, right? You cannot change the query. You are passing the dynamic variables, that is okay. But still, the whatever the query which you have written is just static. You cannot change that query, isn't it? But using a dynamic cursor, using a ref cursor, what I can do is I can change my query at runtime. Using a reference ref cursor, I can change the query at runtime. And also that ref cursor can hold the data of, you know, like a first thing is the query can be changed and the number of column doesn't matter too. I mean to say, like, you can have any query with any number of columns. It's not that, you know, like the new query also should have same number of columns, same number of records, nothing like that. So that's a concept of RefCursor.
We'll see, right, with the example.
Yeah, that's what I'm telling. So because it takes good amount of time, so that is the reason, you know, like even if we discuss today, it will again we cannot cover up. And also there is a something called dynamic SQL. So we'll cover up both in a single session. Okay, dynamic SQL as well as RefCursor. And we have some other important topic within PL SQL. Of course, we have many other, but maybe before starting the real procedures and functions, we'll be finishing up these things. Okay, then we'll start with the procedure and a function and package. So, RefCursor, dynamic SQL, and exceptions. Okay, then the PL SQL stuff.
Okay.
Yeah. So then, bye.